belongs to Glasgow, dear old Glasgow town. But there's something the matter with Glasgow, for it's going round and round. I'm only a common old working lad, as anyone can see. But when I get a couple of drinks on a Saturday, Glasgow belongs to me.
Hi folks, I hope you're all well, and welcome to Pure Buzzin, the brand new podcast slash vlog aimed at spreading the message of positivity in and around the hospitality sector in Glasgow. Coming to you in association with Glasgow Taxis. Glasgow Taxis have been big supporters of the hospitality industry in Glasgow, and it's great to see Dougie and his team continue in that vein. Before we start, let us tell you a wee bit more about Pure Buzzin.
So every month, we want to bring you news and updates of a positive nature from the hospitality scene in and around Glasgow. We want everyone to know that Glasgow is open for business, and we mean business. We'll be joined each month by an array of brilliant guests from the world of hospitality and areas that are closely associated with us, such as retail, hospitality, transport and entertainment. We plan to showcase different locations. And of course, we've got this beautiful city to show off, so we want everyone to know that this is our home. Well, we can't ignore what we're going through at the moment. We're trying not to constantly go on about COVID-19. We want everyone to know that we're all about spreading the positivity, and we can't wait to hear about what you're pure buzzing about. So let's introduce ourselves.
My name's Alan. I've been working in hospitality for a little over 30 years now, mainly as a concierge in and around Glasgow in the west of Scotland. I know you're thinking, 30 years, must have started as a child.
And my name's Hannah. I'm the current business development manager in Chaophraya, Glasgow. My entire working career so far has been in hospitality, and that's ranged from cafes to bars, planning weddings, and now I've landed in restaurants. I'm quite new to the city centre, and it's been lovely so far this year to see how welcoming everyone has been to getting to know me and what I do.
And not forgetting our very own Wizards of Oz, the men behind the curtain pulling all the technical strings, Mr. Liam Bedwell and Mr. Liam Florence.
We can all be connected and contacted through LinkedIn, so please do get in touch, give us any feedback, and if you want to get involved, please do let us know. But without further ado, let us introduce our guest for today.
So, he's currently Associate Dean for Hospitality and Tourism at the City of Glasgow College. He's also the founder of the mental health charity, Hospitality Health, offering an outlet to our colleagues in the hospitality industry in Scotland. They may find themselves in need of someone to talk to or some other form of support. If you scratch the surface of his achievements, you'll see that they include the Caterer.com Ambassador Award, the Industry Fellowship Award from the Scottish Hotel Awards. He's the recipient of the Hit Scotland Industry Award. As well as all that, he's shortlisted again in 2020 for a Ketty, the third year in a row, a fantastic achievement, I'm sure you all agree. Welcome, Mr. Gordon McIntyre.
Alan, Hannah, thank
Hello.
You. Thank you very much indeed for that warm welcome. It makes me sound I'm good there, but I'm not that brilliant, honestly. I'm not that brilliant, but thank you for the very warm welcome and kind words. Very much appreciate that.
Before we start, guys, shall we just talk about what we're pure buzzing about this week?
Definitely, yeah. Definitely.
Alan?
Well, I'm pure buzzing. I should be saying I'm pure buzzing about the Grand Central, my current hotel reopening, but we've moved the goalposts on that slightly, so what I'll say is I'm pure buzzing about deep dish pizza. there's a new deep house pizza, it's called, opened in the east end of Glasgow, and I'm pure buzzing to try that. I can't wait.
Brilliant.
Good call. I'm buzzing for you.
I'm joining the queue.
Well, for me, Chaophraya is open and trading just now from 12 till 6. So it's been nice actually to interact with customers still working. But really, I did actually buy an Iron Brew flavoured soap at the weekend, and I'm super excited about it. Bit of a weird one, but I mean, it's Glasgow.
And it what is. Good bit of news, so yeah, why not?
Just be careful you don't eat it, Hannah.
I know, I mean, yeah, might have to. See what it tastes. No.
My smells goodness good gracious. Mine sounds quite tame to the two of you. I'm pure buzzing though, and I'm pure buzzing because the clocks went back a few weeks ago, an extra hour in bed, which was brilliant. Mm-hmm. But more so, it's the colours of autumn. I just love getting out, yeah. The fresh air, walking around, good for mental health as well.
Absolutely.
But the colours, I have to say, along that Kelvin Way, Kelvin Grove Park, were absolutely beautiful. And I don't know whether you're up still. I know you sometimes do night shift, Alan, but right. The sunsets were brilliant this past few weeks. They really were. So it's
I had a walk along
the
Kelvin. It was beautiful.
Awesome.
Yeah,
awesome.
Absolutely.
That makes us all feel good.
Yeah.
It really does.
But yours sounds so much more cultured than yours.
Certainly buzzing.
Aye.
And I'm buzzing to be here.
Yeah, absolutely. We're buzzing to have you
Thanks
here.
For having me.
So tell us a wee bit. So Associate Dean at the City of Glasgow College for Hospitality and Tourism. Tell us a wee bit how you got there.
Well, I've been there for a reasonably long time, but let me go back to the beginning, because I think it's important to know where I've come from. I'm Glaswegian through and through, but I did go to a primary school in a wee village called Strachur. I grew up in St Catharines on the lovely banks of Loch Fyne in Argyll. It's a part of the world I go back to often on my mountain bike just to get refreshed and recharged, revitalised, which is brilliant. But came back to the big school in Glasgow, and so I did my high school in Glasgow, and then on to the wonderful City of Glasgow College, which back then was known as the Food Tech. Do you remember that place? College of Food Technology. It was a place to be for education and training in our industry. So I graduated with
it
an HND.
It very different back then.
It certainly did. It's a different building now, Alan, you're right. Graduated from there, and then I went on to work for, I was up in Argyll again at Stonefield Castle, worked for Stachys Hotels, which many people listening to this will remember and know well. And I then did a wee bit of travelling around the world with P&O Cruises as a purser on a cruise ship. Back to the city
Fantastic.
Again to work for Finlay Brothers, and I think some of the viewers and listeners will remember Finlay Brothers, a great pub company within the City of Glasgow, before I went into further education. And I've been there for a reasonably long time, I have to say.
But, talking about you growing up, were you part of a large family, many siblings, or...?
That's a cracking question. I don't know whether someone's fed you that question. But yes, I had a fantastic family. Awesome parents. Let me start with Mum and Dad, who certainly made me, I think, the person that I am. But I have to say, I've got two brothers and I've got a sister. And what's interesting about them is that some are quite closely linked to the hospitality industry too.
Oh, right, OK.
Can I tell you a bit about them or not?
Absolutely, please do.
But, first of all, I say my brother, he went to sea, my older brother, and that was my father's influence. He said, go to sea, see the world. And he was in the Navy himself for a period of time, and I didn't really want to do that. My brother did. He became a first officer and was sailing cargo ships around the world. And so I put off, but then eventually, if you like, I saw this advert for a purser on a cruise ship, the Canberra, the Sea Princess, the Oriana, and I thought, wow, this is pretty good. So I got a job. It was hotel services department on the ship. I have to say, I did a bit better than my brother. He was going to container terminals at the tail of the bank in these various places. I was going right into the sort of tourist resorts on my cruise ship, and I was seeing the beautiful sunny places to go. So I think I get the best deal there. But my sister also went to the food tech, and she worked for a company back then, a hotel company you might remember, called Trust House 40, THF. So she did a graduate recruitment programme with them and is still in the industry. And she recently, believe it or not, has come also to become a lecturer College in Glasgow. So she's very much kind of almost followed my footsteps in some ways. But my younger brother, he's an absolute star, and he's in the sector, but slightly different. He's in manufacturing, and he is the distillery manager, an award-winning distillery manager, I should say, for Ian McLeod Distillers up at Tam Doo, which is up in Speyside. Not that I want to say drink Tam Doo, there's lots of whiskies out there. And we know Glengoyne's a Glasgow whisky.
Oh, yep.
We should maybe mention that.
I was just about to say Glengoyne fall under Ian McLeod. And
it does as well.
Big supporters of the industry.
Absolutely.
And they're always getting involved in stuff.
Very much so.
You know, the concierge, there's always, every year's a concierge day where we go and visit Glengoyne and Sarah Vaughan and not forgetting Big Stuart, the guys that all look after us up there. And
fantastic.
Yeah, we might walk in a straight line on the way in. We definitely don't on the way out.
Keep the rest after this. We don't want to have this on camera or on recording, I don't think,
you know, Alan. A wee interesting fact, you're saying you worked at sea and what have you, and in the hospitality industry, we're used to looking after posh people. I don't know how true this is or not, but do you know where the word posh comes from?
I actually do, yes.
You can educate
you
me.
You want to enlighten us or do you want me to?
I'll let you tell us that one because you started it.
So the word posh comes from rich people going to sea on a cruise, getting the very best of cabins, and the best cabins would be port out as you're leaving, but you get the starboard on the way home. So posh is port out, starboard home. Just a wee link there to your life at sea.
That's fantastic. Spot on. And P&O, the company I worked for, actually had a posh club. And this was a club for, if you like, loyalty.
So it is actually true, that?
Yeah, absolutely bang on. Amazing. Absolutely bang on. That's fantastic. Superb. One wee bit I can maybe add about my family, because that's where we're sort of left off in that, is that both my mother and my father, if you like, how did I get into hospitality? It was in my blood in some ways, because my father, your side of town, the East End, my father's family, back in the early 1900s, I should say, had pubs in the Gallagate and East End of Glasgow. McIntyre's Bar and Rob Roy were two pubs that they had out in the East End of Glasgow. And on my mother's side, the Stirling family, they had hotels on the west coast of Scotland, down in Dunoon, Largs, is where the hospitality industries were located. So yeah. I suppose from my mother and father, they were in the sector, they were in the industry, and it maybe wasn't a huge surprise for me to find myself and my sister and my brother and so on following us through into that industry. So that's maybe where we come from.
So pretty much your whole family?
Yeah.
Absolutely. To go towards sort of hospitality.
It's become a natural thing to do. I have to say. So there we are.
Yeah. So the hospitality health, and so important to give our colleagues access to a service like this.
Yeah.
Given what we're going through at the moment.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I agree. I think particularly this year, it's something that I have noticed has been like so strong. It's just the fact that everyone in the industry, particularly in Glasgow, has really rallied round each other, and it's been lovely actually to be a part of.
Yep. Very much right. I think you're right. Hospitality is a family. You know, I think if you're in this industry, you do feel part of a family.
Yeah.
And I think that's absolutely right. So when it comes to what we've now founded in the charity, it's supporting everybody that we've been working along with, all the way through. Mm-hmm. And part of that, I suppose, has come from me with the College Link, and I've been at the college, as I've said, for quite a lot of years. But I'm seeing, if you like, mental health in young people to start with, never mind the industry. So with students, we're seeing their resilience maybe isn't quite as strong as it maybe used to be.
Yeah.
If they get bad news about maybe not passing an assessment first time, or it could be a member of their family might be diagnosed with a terminal illness, that really sets them back. So we did look at that to think, what we can do to help these young people, first of all, in the hospitality courses, tourism courses in the college. And then we thought, let's do more. What else can we do to move that further out into the sector?
People aren't always happy to talk to maybe somebody that you work with or somebody that you know, even a close family member. People might find it difficult to open up to somebody that's quite close to you
Absolutely.
Would you be an advocate of the message? It's okay to not be okay.
Absolutely.
And it's okay to say that you're not okay.
Hugely. And I think things have changed in the past number of years. We founded the charity just over two years ago, really, it was founded, but we launched it at the Grand Central, I should say, thanks to Paul and the team, a year past in January. Mm. So that launch took place 18 months or so ago. But what I have to say, really, is that things were changing even by that time. And I think in some ways, the royal family helped that a wee bit, because we do know that they started to talk a wee bit more about circumstances, and that opened doors for other people to say it's okay to talk about these things. But I think what's also happened is, as we're seeing people in generations moving up, they're hearing these messages.
Yeah.
They're understanding that tough times are here, how do we cope with them?
Absolutely.
And they're not frightened to ask and to speak to friends or speak to colleagues. Yeah. But what we also felt would be the right thing to do within the family, we know that there are other organisations like, you know, SAMH, Samaritans and various other organisations which provide fantastic help and support. Mm. People in the hospitality industry, you know yourself, as I've said before, it's a family.
Yeah.
If they could talk to somebody within that sector, they might be happier to open up and have that conversation. So that's why we felt, let's do something. There is Hospitality Action in London, a very good charity that I know Mark Lewis very well, the CEO. But what we felt was, in Scotland, we like Scotland, in Glasgow, we like Glasgow.
Yeah.
That's why we're doing Pure Buzzin.
Yeah.
So I think it's important that we formed this in Glasgow and Scotland to say it's for people in Scotland and our industry.
Yeah.
And so the money we fundraise in Scotland is spent in Scotland.
Yeah.
It's not something that's remote further south. That's how we do it, you know.
And people in London may be dealing with this whole thing in a completely different way, and it's somebody more local probably get a better understanding of what we're going through locally.
Very much so. And I think in hospitality, and you've worked down south in various places, Scotland and Glasgow is really different to London and England. The South East is a different world completely. Yep. And I think people up here, I think we'd rather have support with a Scottish voice and support from a Scottish organisation.
Yep. Particularly so to have support from a hospitality standpoint as well, because our industry is so standalone, and the hours that we work and the teams that we work with and the job that's required of us. And so I think it's fantastic that you've got that kind of individual bit of help.
Yeah. And some of the stories that I've heard since I've been doing this are really quite tragic and sad. And you're absolutely right, Hannah, if you talk about our hours. So you can imagine the industry. You're working long hours, but you might finish at 11 o'clock at night. Mm-hmm. We used to get a thing in the kitchen called a sweat pint. That's not really what I'd suggest we advocate anymore. Mm-hmm. That's encouraging alcohol. We're trying to move away from that, much you've as we enjoy a wee drink.
You've just upset chefs everywhere.
I know.
I'm not in Glasgow right now, anyway.
But we can't really encourage that. But what has been happening is they have that one beer or one Negroni, whatever it happens to be they happen to have, but then they'll go to a venue that's open later.
Absolutely.
They then might find themselves going to a casino, and the drink then leads to gambling.
Yep.
And before we know it, the circumstances, it's a downward spiral. And they then find themselves in a very difficult way to get back out. And it's not just their own lives they're taking with them.
Yep.
There's families, there's children, and so on and so forth. So it's important interventions can get put in place and we can provide support for them to try and prevent it getting too bad too soon, I have to say.
Other signs, maybe a change in behaviour or little things that, as a colleague or a friend, that you can look out for?
I think there is. And sometimes it's very subtle. Sometimes it's maybe more obvious. Mm. The one thing that the charity has started to do with the funds we've raised is we're paying for mental health first aid training. And so one of the positives out of COVID is we're now delivering these online. So we've got people from all over Scotland on a Zoom call with an organisation called the Good Mental Health Company. 2 days training on Zoom with a number of PowerPoint slides and a workbook to go with it, and they're going to get a certificate as mental health first aiders. Now, we know we've got first aiders in work by legislation. We need to have that. Legislation doesn't say we need mental health first aiders, but we're saying this is what we need more of.
Yeah.
So we're now, if you like, putting that training in place. But you don't need to have the training. You're absolutely right, Alan. What we need to try to do is to make people just to sort of take that time out and look for some signs. And the signs can be almost polarised. It could be someone who's normally quite talkative becomes very quiet. Mm-hmm. And you think, that's funny. Normally they would say hello on the way past, but they haven't. They've just gone straight into work. Or it could be the other side of it as well. It could be someone that's maybe normally quiet becomes very chatty.
Yeah.
And you might think, hold on a minute, that person's talking 10 to the dozen here. And that's another thing just to look for. It's a polarisation. It's the changes in the behaviour as opposed to someone that becomes quiet, because we sometimes associate quietness with depression and you think that's the way people might become insular. But it's the opposite can equally give you a signal to think, hold on a minute, that person needs help. And I suppose what you do about it is the thing you might then think, you know, what can we do? And it sounds easy to say, but the most important thing is just to stop the world from spinning around for a moment or two and say to that person, have you got time for a cup of tea or a cup of coffee? Or how about a drink of water?
Yeah.
Let's sit and talk. And we don't do that often enough.
Yeah.
And when I also say talk, I should also say listen. Because I think what's important is when we're talking to these people, we don't want to talk too much. We want them to talk.
Yeah.
And we want to do the listening. The old adage of you've got 2 ears and one mouth when you're doing that kind of interview scenario is that let's listen and listen actively.
Yeah.
And let them ramble, let them get it off their chest, because, you know, it's an old sort of story as well, you know, a problem shares a problem half.
Absolutely.
And that sometimes just works. And so that's you on the right step of giving that person support.
Open that barrier. Yeah.
Exactly. And I think by doing that, they're going to start to develop a relationship with you or whoever it happens to be that starts the conversation, and that opens the opportunity for further discussion and support that can move on.
I think for us, particularly in this industry, we have a bit of a show face for customers. So it's almost like a split personality.
Yeah.
You've kind of got the home Hannah and then
put
the work Hannah. Exactly. So it's like a showman comes in.
Yep.
And so, I think it is just even having someone to ask you honestly about how you're feeling and how you are doing is, so important.
I love that word, honestly. Because we just say, how are you? And I just answer, oh, I'm fine. But, you know, to ask that honestly, Hannah, you're so right. And it's to ask it in a really way shows you're caring. And people then hopefully will be like, oh, you mean what you're asking.
Yeah.
You're not just saying, how are you? It's not like a good morning. It's a genuine, how are you? Absolutely right.
You were talking there about, you know, taking somebody for a wee cup of tea or a wee drink and sitting having a chat. I mean, if you think somebody's got an issue, I mean, somebody might be uncomfortable about approaching somebody, you know, might feel uncomfortable. Maybe I've misread the signs, maybe they're all right. And, you know, so what would be the correct way of approaching, you know, if you think somebody's maybe there?
Well, I think it's a good point, because people are nervous at touching this subject. Yeah. It's not just a simple conversation. And I would also say that if the person doesn't want to open up to you, don't push it, because that could cause them more stress and distress. Distress if they then think, oh my God, I don't want to speak about this, but you're forcing me. Yeah. That then becomes a negative. But maybe it becomes a situation that the next day, ask the question again. Don't, if you like, give up on that individual just because the first time you've spoken to them, that they've said, no, I'm fine. Do the same thing the next day and the day after that. And even say, listen, if you feel like talking, why not give me a phone or a text? They might not want to do that face to face. But it's important, I think, that they know that you're there and you're caring is the important aspect of it. And different people like to communicate in different ways.
Absolutely.
And so to open that door by saying, listen, you've got my number. Mm-hmm. After work, if you want to text or you want to phone or you want to go for a coffee, you know, we don't have to do it here. We can do it at another time. And hopefully, eventually, they'll think, this person's genuine. They are, to use your word honestly, showing an interest and paying attention to my needs, my health. And they will eventually think, yeah, I need to talk.
Maybe just in an environment that they feel more comfortable.
That's right, that's right. Less stressful than they might be. And that'll definitely work.
So one of the shining lights of the last couple of years is Gary McLean. Master Chef and Professionals came back with Pure Buzzin about that, by the way. I've not seen it yet, I've taped it. But I started again last night, and Gary McLean been one of the shining lights to come out of the college the last couple of years, and what a success that's been. And
It really has. Well, I was watching it last night, and it's funny, you know, we're talking about that today. I was texting Gary last night just because it's excitement, and because when you think of MasterChef, at least I think of Gary McLean, as you have done as well. And he's been a great advocate for the college since he won that. I should say that that programme gets recorded over the summer months, so Gary's summer holidays that year were not summer holidays. He was down in London in an industrial unit with the MasterChef team doing the pressure cooking and the recording. So he didn't have a summer off. Obviously, the wonderful benefit was that he won it. Mm-hmm. But no one knew that, because you're right, we're in November, so they start to like transmitting that in November, and the result comes out at the end of December, almost just before Christmas. And that's how it was for Gary. So really, that programme started to get broadcast, and everyone at the college is buzzing about it. You know, we're pure buzzing watching Gary. We're talking about the next day, because he's back at college by this time. But he couldn't say a word, you know. He just said, oh, it's a difficult night. When you watch this, you'll see this, you'll see that. He could not say a word, and he was sworn to total secrecy. Until on the night, then you realise that Gary McLean's won it.
But you say they had a team working with him?
When you say a team...
You said, I thought you said they had a unit. Did he say had some guys working with him down there helping him? Or?
Well, he would be on the phone to some people back here sometimes to say, I've got this to do, or I've got that to do. You know, I think the ingredients are this, the mystery basket's that, or I'm going off to whatever restaurant it is to get the challenge in. And so guys up here, there was a few folk he sort of confided in a wee bit to say, I don't know what'll happen next, I don't know what'll happen next, but he could not tell anyone really what was going on. And what happened, actually, Hannah, you're right. What happened was they filmed all four finalists receiving the trophy. And I believe this is true from Gary, that if he were to have told the story, and imagine Glasgow's Daily Record got that, they'd be pure buzzing with the story. He would have been actually, if you like, disqualified from the competition. They would have had to award the trophy to somebody else because he'd have leaked that story out. So he was under great pressure. But the most delightful thing about it, he won it, but then he came back to the, or he was at the college, but then had classes at the college. But the class that he'd normally teach, because different chef lecturers and lecturers at the college have got classes they might see more of than others. And what a wonderful welcome he got that day when it was broadcast that he was a winner. You know, the next day he comes in and there's banners, there's balloons, there's all sorts going on, you know, and it was just a great pappy atmosphere. But since then, of course, he has been given the Scotland's National Chef accolade as well, so he's representing the Scottish Government abroad and at food fairs, festivals and various things around Scotland, so that's pushed him. He's got his book, of course, too, and he's worked with students at various times to help the preparation, so the students have been involved
private
to a certain extent.
Private
for that
dinners
well.
At Chateau McIntyre.
He's never been around to my house, I have to say. No. Get that on the record. But no, absolutely brilliant and good for the college and the brand, I have to say, from that point of view. It's been a great success.
He can't have been the only success.
No, you're right. I think we're very lucky at the college. We've got this one wonderful building, and I'm sure many folk in Glasgow that are listening to this and are watching this will have seen it in Cathedral Street. It's a massive, iconic building. Opposite Strathclyde University. It's got all the facilities you'd expect it to have for hospitality, tourism, events management in there. We've even got an airline cabin for our cabin crew
training. I didn't realise that.
So you need to come up and see it, Hannah. You need
definitely.
To come up and see it. And so it's got fantastic resources, but the best resource is the staff. You know, no building is any good without the staff and also the students. So much as we've got lovely space, it's the people that count, I have to say, in there. And we've got great success because our best ambassadors are our students. And I think in the UK, there's probably three institutions that are always vying for the top award in competitions. There's University of Birmingham in the Midlands direction. We've got Westminster Kingsway down in London and City of Glasgow, obviously, up here in Scotland. Yeah. And there are a number of cookery competitions, barista competitions, front of house service competitions. And I have to say, I'm delighted and so proud that City of Glasgow are always up there. We're in the finals of everything.
Yeah.
And particularly the big one, which we've just recently won again, is Nestle Top Door, which is one of the best student competitions that there is in the country. And our front of house, Alex Dick, young man, won that this year. Previous years, our teams have won that. So, you know, the students are awesome. We've had students out in Malaysia and Singapore winning barista medals.
Wow, brilliant.
We've got students competing in India. Gary's taken a young man out to India before competing in culinary competitions. So, so we don't just compete in Glasgow, Scotland, and the UK, but it's international, you know? Yeah. But our staff, I should pay great credit to our staff because the staff that we've got are highly talented, they're highly specialist. They're individuals, but they're continually updating their own professional development. Mm-hmm. And we've got several award winners in amongst our staff as well. And if it wasn't for them, I think the inspiring young people we're seeing coming through today wouldn't be there. One, if I could maybe mention particularly, we know the only two-star Michelin restaurant in Scotland is restaurant Andy Fairley, who sadly we just lost recently. But the head chef and who's managing that now is a chef called Stevie McLaughlin. Now, Stevie is a head chef. He's got Dale in front, looking after the front of the house. But Stevie McLaughlin is a graduate of City of Glasgow College. So there we have got the head chef, and the only two Michelin star restaurant is one of our graduates. So we're really quite proud of that as well. So I could go on all day, Alan, and Hannah, you know, you have to stop me. You have to stop me. There's so many great things going on up there that I could speak all day about that. Yeah. But thanks for giving me the chance.
Absolutely. Pleasure.
Should we get on to some news?
Yeah, some news. here comes the news.
I guess each week we're just going to talk about some current news stories. So one that I would like to share, the list of top 100 Scottish women in Scottish tourism has just been announced. And there's loads of great names on there.
I know, it's amazing.
So like, so worthy of recognition.
From Glasgow as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I know Salan Tyndall, who supports us at Experience Glasgow so much.
Eileen
Scottish
Enterprises
there. Eileen, that's right, exactly.
So I just wanted to say well done, ladies. Yeah. Good job.
That's a good one.
Ladies flying a flag, as always.
I know, as always.
So the I picked up on the story is the Hilton in Glasgow. A hotel is quite the that I've got a wee connection with is when I finished my YTS.
YTS?
My YTS.
Gracious, I remember teaching YTS when I was a boy.
When I finished my YTS in hall portering.
Love it.
And my first job in a proper concierge department was at the Hilton in Glasgow. And so I was one of the pioneers, if you like, when the Glasgow Hilton opened. And they're getting a refurbishment as they're closed at the moment, as far as I'm aware. But whilst they're closed, I'm led to believe from Chef Murphy, who's been on the phone,
young James,
make sure he gets a plug in. But I'm led to believe they're undergoing a massive refurbishment, and so often the big multinational hotel companies and what have you, when they're getting spending so much money on architecture, design, whatever, they'll go to London or somewhere else down south.
Absolutely.
Great to see the Bell and Swift.
Wow.
Is a design company. I believe their offices are on the Gallowgate.
Fantastic.
And they're going for a real Glasgow feel, and it's going to be Rennie McIntosh design.
Wow. Fantastic.
Well done,
Glasgow company giving it a Glasgow feel.
Five-star hotel. So you can always say well done to Hilton Glasgow for keeping that sort of work, keeping that sort of work local, you know.
Definitely. Yeah. A wee bit like what you mentioned, Hannah, the news for me is about celebrating success, and we know the Queen's birthday honours were slightly delayed this year for obvious reasons, but wonderful to see hospitality people and Scottish hospitality people recognised, and David Cochrane, who we know is the Chief Executive of HIT Scotland, works exceedingly hard providing scholarships and bursaries, as well as all these events we're missing hugely right now, because we'd normally be at a Christmas party coming up soon for HIT, so there'd be a Glasgow lunch, all of these things have been decimated, as we know. But delighted to see that David was recognised with a medal in the Queen's Honours. Yeah. He's got an MBE, which is fantastic, so well deserved, and congratulations
absolutely
to David.
Absolutely well deserved, yeah. I know David well, and yeah.
Another David, a Glasgow David this time, David Maguire, who's got a restaurant out in Great Western Road, GWR, just beside Gartnavel Hospital. Yep. Through the pandemic, the first lockdown, he was involved in feeding the NHS workers, key workers, through some sponsorship, first of all, and then through crowdfunding. Yep. He set that up, and he's been recognised as well there. You know it well. Yep. That, so congratulations to David Maguire. He was a chair, in fact, of the Glasgow Restaurant Association a number of years ago as well. Yeah. So well done to him, and it's great to see Glaswegians recognised in that
really
honour
as well.
And a great initiative doing that for the NHS guys.
Absolutely.
Big massive thank you to all the NHS guys for the last 6 months' work.
Definitely.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Keeping Glasgow safe.
Absolutely. And I don't know if you've seen this on the news, but Denniston has just been voted the 8th coolest city in the world to live.
Amazing.
Yeah. And so that's where all my favourite cafes are. So I just wanted to mention that. How big of an achievement is that?
That's awesome. That is brilliant. Once again, Glasgow's on the map.
Yeah, back out to my neck of the woods again.
That's maybe why they've chosen it.
Yeah, you walk
they knew
up
it was
Duke,
coming.
You walk up Duke Street just now. It's
amazing, isn't it?
For anyone who's not been in Duke Street for the last 20 years or so, you would not recognise it. All these fantastic sort of little coffee houses and restaurants.
It's fantastic,
and
isn't it?
I think that's one of the things that's fantastic about Glasgow compared to certainly Edinburgh and other cities is we've got so many independent entrepreneurs, operators there. It's not the big brands that we've got necessarily in the city. We've got these independent operators who are taking a chance in Glasgow. See what we need, and they're providing fantastic hospitality, fantastic service, and great food. Very often sourced locally as well. You know.
Mm-hmm. Really, somebody said to me a while back, you know, the East End's the new West End. No, the East End's always been there.
And you've always been biased, Alan McDougall.
Sure, they said that about the South as well.
One of the initiatives that really helped the city out over the last few months was when the city offered free parking, on-street parking. But obviously that's not feasible to keep that up forever. Yeah. So Sandra and the guys at NCP have come up with some fantastic deals for everyone to use. It's not one of these keep to yourself idea things. It's getting the word out there, you know, your family, friends, customers, colleagues.
Absolutely.
Tell everyone, you know, we're going to put the deals up on the screen now, but £3 for 5 hours parking in the city, you know. There's a £4 deal for all day at Central Station and £5 for 24 hours at Glasford Street. And we're going to put all those deals up on the screen so that everyone can get involved and make use of those. So,
I've used that a couple of times already, just getting into work. And it's been so helpful.
But what's good about that is it's different car parks across the city. So you've got retailers and restaurants that are going to benefit, whether it's the city centre, east side or the west side of the city centre. That's fantastic. That's a great gesture just to get the footfall back up again.
Absolutely.
You know how the footfall's gone.
Yeah.
But if that brings it back in again with an offer like that, folk are going to come back into the city and hopefully spend their money.
5 hour time slot, you've got plenty of time for the shops, you can do some dining, a bit of a walk around,
a shop, a bit of lunch.
Easy.
Maybe £3 for the car park.
Absolutely.
Maybe even catch up with another household if you're allowed to, you know what I mean? It's going to be a bonus. Absolutely, right?
Absolutely. So, many thanks to Sandra and the guys at NCP there. Brilliant initiative.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
We just want to say a big thanks to you today for coming on.
Thank you to both of you
for
inviting me along. I really appreciate getting a chance to showcase hospitality health and say a good few things about the college because we're very proud of what we do. So thank you for inviting me along. Appreciate it.
Yeah.
It's been good
fun. Pleasure. And thanks to Jason, Jacqueline and all the guys down here at the Crown Plaza for giving us this lovely location and keeping us supplied with a coffee to get us going this morning.
It was needed. And to Glasgow Taxis as well, our sponsors.
Don't forget our sponsors. Glasgow Taxis, Dugan the guys, done a great job keeping the city moving.
Definitely.
That's what we need.
Yeah.
Safely.
Yes. Clean, safe, compliant. Yeah.
We really do hope that you enjoyed the chat today and enjoyed the podcast. Please do like and share our social channels. We're going to be putting a competition out each month. This month it will be a meal in Chaophraya.
So please do tag maybe a friend from hospitality that you want to share a meal with. We'll be choosing a winner at the start of next month's podcast. So please, there'll be multiple entries as well, so tag as many people as you want and get the word out there for us. Next month, do you want to talk about our guest?
Yeah, so next month is December, Christmas already. Oh. Where does the time go?
Where has the year gone, Alan?
Well, I know where the year can go. But next month we're coming from Corinthian Club on Ingram Street. And we'll be getting all Christmassied up. Wearing our Christmas jumpers and
beautiful.
Santa hats.
Beautiful.
And we'll be inviting along Louise Brody, who is the head of guest experience down at Cameron House.
Great venue. Lovely
come
lady.
To come and talk to us about our... how the guys are getting on up there her story so
definitely.
Far.
No, yeah. Great
absolutely.
To hear, because I know there's been big plans. The renovations are going on up there. I know that great team are working up there too. And I think Andy has been doing a great job leading the team. So it'll be
absolutely.
Good to hear how they're getting on. Fantastic.
Trying to bust out our Christmas jumpers.
Yep, absolutely.
Need to go to the loft for that.
I know.
Dust off the Christmas jumpers.
But the Corinthian will be looking fantastic. They'll have a tree, I'm sure.
Yeah,
it'll
gorgeous.
Be tinsel, sparkling lights.
Some Baileys.
Yeah,
who knows?
Baileys, a wee cocktail.
Maybe
or two.
A mulled wine. No alcohol at the moment, I suppose.
Of course.
Non-alcoholic mulled wine.
Maybe lay off the NCP car parking deal that
day. Yeah, absolutely. So, shall we finish off today with our resident band?
Yeah. Our house band, the guys at Cap and Copy, are going to take us out with their version of Mumford & Sons' I Will Wait.
Brilliant.
And look forward to seeing you in December.
Yeah.
Thank you very
so
much.
Thank you.
So take my flesh and fix my eyes.